Thank you.
Well, thank you all very much, Father Dave, for having me and for involving me in the University Series, which is, I think, one of the great things going on in the church today. And I'm just delighted to be bishop now in this region. It still seems a little bit incredible to me. Thank you. Thank you. I've learned the 101 expressway very well in my time so far, going back and forth to Santa Barbara. But I love this region. It's beautiful. All the way up to, you know, Santa Maria and Guadalupe, and then all the way to this side of the empire. Wherever you go, it's beautiful here. The other day, I was on the back porch of my house in Santa Barbara, which looks up at the beautiful Santa Ynez Mountains. And I was out there reading on the back porch, and my mother called. And so she said, how's the weather out there? I said, well, it's about 77, and it's a bright blue sky. I'm looking up at the mountains. I said, how's the weather back home, Chicago? Oh, it's 15, and snow is coming. So she said, do you miss it? I said, no, I do not miss it. I really am delighted to be here. It's almost 6 months now, hard to believe, I've been ordained. And spending a lot of time getting to know this region, which, as I say, I've loved. And loved just being able to teach and preach and evangelize and meet people. Had my first confirmations about a week ago, so we got those under my belt. My first rite of election yesterday, so I'm doing a lot of the Episcopal things and enjoying it. So listen, I want to talk to you tonight about what I call the YouTube heresies. I'll tell you where this comes from. So some years ago now, in my Word on Fire work, I got a nice donation, and the person that gave me the money said, do something creative with this. And at the time, this was about 2006, at the time, YouTube had just come into being. And mostly it was, you know, my cat jumps off the roof. You know, people would have some silly video. So I said, well, why don't we, you know, try something. I'll make videos commenting on the culture, on movies and music and whatever. And we'll see if anyone watches. And to be perfectly honest with you, we had no idea if anybody would watch. I thought maybe my mother. My mother doesn't watch, by the way. Do you know one of her lines to me, this was about 5 years ago, she goes, Bobby, do you think you're a little overexposed? My mother, you know? Anyway, so she doesn't watch, but we started making these videos, and the first one was on Martin Scorsese's film, The Departed. It just came out, and I'd just seen it, so I did a video commenting on that. Well, at first we got a couple hundred viewers. We were thrilled, I remember, when we got to 300 views for one of our videos. Now, some years later, we've approaching now 17 million views of these videos. So it's, I think if we are bold and clear and inventive and creative, we can really have an effect on the wider culture. That's another talk I could give. But in the course of this work on YouTube, people can comment, you know, on the videos. I didn't know that at first. I quickly found out. Because, you know, let's face it, people in the wider secular world are often deeply hostile to religion. But see, I liked it from the beginning, honestly, because it proved to me I was reaching outside the walls of the church, which is what I wanted. I was getting out to the wider culture. And people that hated God, they hated religion, they hated me, whatever it was, they would comment. But then, see, I could get involved. I could answer back. And often these long conversations would ensue. And what happened in this process now over many years is I discovered pretty quickly the major objections people have to the Catholic faith. What's blocking people from coming to us? So I was evangelizing outside the walls of the church and coming up against, and I've named them now as four standard objections. And here they are. I'm going to talk briefly about each one tonight. First of all, there's deep confusion about God. See, now, let me say this. One thing's interesting. When I was coming of age in the church, so right after Vatican II, what were we talking about and fighting about? It was a lot of issues of authority and sexuality, right? We were talking about birth control and divorce and remarriage, and we're talking about who has power, laity, priests, etc. Those aren't the issues, though, for people on YouTube, in my experience. Younger people, those aren't the issues. The issues are far more fundamental. See, the great Vatican II generation, I took a lot of the fundamentals of the faith for granted. And they fought about these more inner churchy sort of things. And again, not to denigrate that, they're important questions and all that. But the younger people, those aren't their issues. God is a big issue. God. There are atheist clubs, you know, springing up all over America. The new atheists have tons of followers among the younger people. So clarity about God. Second issue, deep confusion about the Bible. People really balk on the Bible. The Bible bugs a lot of people. Third issue, and this is the one that I think we advertised, religion and science. Religion and science is a major block for young people. They think that science has trumped religion. Fourthly, religion in relation to violence. That religion is the source of violence. Religion stirred up most of the wars, et cetera, et cetera. So God, the Bible, science, and violence, I find are the big four. The big four reasons people are not coming to the church. So let me just say something simple about each one. That's the talk tonight. God. One of my favorite theologians is Herbert McCabe. I don't know if you know that name. A Dominican theologian, died about, oh, 5 or 6 years ago now. McCabe was a kind of public intellectual in Great Britain and would often debate atheists, but he always said, I want the atheist to go first in the debate. So, okay, the atheist would get up, make his position thoroughly, exhaustively. And at the end of it, McCabe would invariably say, I perfectly agree with you. Now, how come? He wasn't just being flip about it. He was acknowledging something. He was announcing something. That what atheists characterize as God is not what serious Catholics mean by the word God. That most atheists are knocking down a not very impressive straw man. And the very thing that they deny, Herbert McCabe would deny. If you read someone like Richard Dawkins, you know, one of the big four new atheists, right? Hitchens and Dawkins, Sam Harris, and Daniel Dennett, the big four, the four horsemen of the new atheism. What did Dawkins give us? Dawkins gave us the flying spaghetti monster. Have you heard that phrase? Go on the internet, go on YouTube, it comes up all the time. His point is, believing in God is as silly and nonsensical and ridiculous as believing in a flying spaghetti monster. It's as inane as that, without evidence, without warrant. In fact, have you seen these things that they're on cars? They'll have a little fish. That means you're a Christian. And then some people have done the fish with the little feet, and it says Darwin, you know. Well, I saw one, no kidding, I saw a flying spaghetti monster on someone's car. It was little meatballs and then the spaghetti-like tentacles. They also refer, and you'll see this too in their disciples on the web, oh, that's nice, you have your little invisible friend. See, that's God. Isn't that nice? Your little invisible friend that helps you. Or Christopher Hitchens would talk about the sky fairy. Isn't that nice? You people believe in a sky fairy. Now, interesting thing. One of my great heroes is Thomas Merton, the Catholic spiritual writer. If you read this beautiful lyrical section of the Seven-Story Mountain, young Merton, 20-something, is kind of a typical secularist modern at this point in his life. Just caught up in the pleasures of the world, full of ambition for his career, etc. And he spies in the window of the Scribner's bookstore in New York this book called The Spirit of Medieval Philosophy by the great philosopher Etienne Gilson. Merton bought the book, began to read it. And what did he find? What did he discover? It changed his life, by the way. He discovered that Catholics have a richly intellectual understanding of God. A subtle and sophisticated understanding of God. And Merton says this in that passage, I always thought of God as a noisy mythological creature. Now think about it, the flying spaghetti monster, the sky fairy, my invisible friend, a noisy mythological creature. What did he find in Etienne Gilson? And I'm going to say a word about it. He found this view from St. Thomas Aquinas. that God, properly understood, is not ens summum, but rather ipsum esse subsistens. I know these are abstractions, I'll explain. What's ens summum? That means the highest being. Ens summum, the highest being. Well, that's God, right? Mm-mm, says Aquinas. You're a being, I'm a being, that's a being, these are beings, Jupiter is a being, the furthest galaxy is a being, Seraph is a being. And then God must be the highest being, right? No. The creator of the heavens and the earth, right? The creator of the universe in its entirety cannot be an item within the universe. Make sense? That which gives rise to the whole of reality. The reason there's something rather than nothing is not one more item among many in the universe. God is not, and I'm using language here from David Burrell, the philosopher at Notre Dame, God is not the biggest thing around. Not the ens summum, but ipsum esse subsistens. That means the sheer act of to be itself. That through which everything in the universe comes to be and remains in being. Not one more item in the world, but the ground and source and cause of the world's existence. Do you remember, some are old enough, back in the 1950s, when the Russian cosmonaut went up into space? Remember, he radios back to Earth. I went all the way up, and there's no God, right? As though God is one more item to be discovered. You know, you read the New Atheists, they have what I refer to as the Yeti theory of God, you know, Bigfoot. Bigfoot, some say there is a Bigfoot, some say there isn't. Let's go look, right? Let's look for evidence. You'll see that a lot. Where's the evidence for God? As though he's like Bigfoot, who's in hiding, and some believe in him, others don't. That's precisely what the true God is not. Not one hidden item among many, but rather that through which the whole universe in its entirety comes to be and stays in being. Now you say, okay, that's an interesting philosophical theory, but what difference does it make? Look, I'll tell you exactly what difference it makes. Exodus 3:14. Moses sees the bush, it's on fire, but not consumed, right? And out of that bush comes the voice of God. I want you to contrast that to the Greek and Roman myths. When the gods, who are just big items within the universe, right? They live up on Mount Olympus, they're like us, they're beings among many. When the gods break into human experience, what happens? People are incinerated. People blow up, they're killed. See, they have to give way to make room for the gods. Because, see, we're competitive. Two physical things can't occupy the same space, right? Psychologically, we can't occupy the same space. There's a mutual exclusivity about finite things. That's why when the gods come in, we got to give way. Now, Exodus 3:14. Here's the bush, a created thing, right? On fire with the presence of God, but not consumed. See what that signals? That the true God is not competitive with the world, but rather when the true God comes close, we become radiant and beautiful, and we are not consumed. There's the non-competitive God of the Bible, translated by Thomas Aquinas into the language of being itself. God is the sheer act of being itself. The more we surrender to that God, the more luminous and beautiful and human we become. Now, another contrast. The new atheists, there's nothing new about them really, except they're nasty. That's what's new about them. But their arguments are as old as the hills. They're borrowed from the classical atheists. People like Ludwig Feuerbach, beginning of the 19th century. What did Feuerbach say? Oh, God is just this fussy projection of our own minds. Wishful thinking, we made him up, right? Which is why Feuerbach famously said, the Nein zu Gott, the no to God, is the Ja zum Menschen, is the yes to us, to man, to humanity. See how that makes sense? If God's a competitor, then the more I say no to God, the more human I become. His disciple, by the way, was Karl Marx. Marx said, we must all be baptized in the Feuerbach. Feuerbach means brook of fire in German, so it's a neat little pun. We must all pass through the fiery brook and be baptized in Feuerbach. What did Marx say? Religion's a silly illusion. It's the opiate of the people. The sooner we get rid of it, the better we're going to be, the more human we'll be. Sigmund Freud was a disciple of both Feuerbach and Marx. What did Freud say? Religion is like a waking dream, right? This dream, this fantasy we cook up. And the sooner we wake up, the sooner we'll move out of our infancy into real adulthood. Same thing, the no to God is the yes to us. Jean-Paul Sartre, right, the founder of existentialism, was a disciple of all three of those gentlemen. What did Sartre say? If God exists, I can't be free. There's a God brooding over my freedom, telling me what to do, dominating me, pushing into my life, manipulating me. If God exists, I can't be free. But I am free. Therefore, there's no God. That starts existentialism. What do they all have in common? They all think of God as a competitor to human flourishing, competing with us on the same plane, pushing us out of the way so he can come to dominate. That's all ens summum language. You see, I'm driving it. That's all God is highest being language. But God is not the highest being. God is the sheer act of being itself. Look, in and through which all things come to be. God is the God of the burning bush. The closer he comes, the more alive we are, which is precisely why, way back in the second century, the great Saint Irenaeus of Lyon, way in advance of Feuerbach, Marx, and Sartre, and Freud, refuted them. Because Irenaeus said, Gloria Dei homo vivens. That means the glory of God is a human being fully alive. Wonderful. Burning bush. We become luminous and radiant and beautiful the closer God gets to us. You know, everybody, I think with our young people in mind, we have done a first-class lousy job at explaining who God is. Because so many have fallen victim to these atheists, old and new, who see God as a threat to human flourishing. We got to get a lot better, it seems to me, at explaining who the true God is. And why, therefore, listen, why Christianity is the greatest humanism ever proposed. You know, the church fathers always said, they had a little adage, they all said it. Deus fit homo, ut homo fieret Deus. That means God became one of us so that we might become divinized. Isn't that beautiful? That's what God becoming one of us means. It means we are being drawn into the power of his life. Don't fall prey to this weird view of God as competing with us, undermining us, compromising us. No, no, the true God makes us human. So there's issue number one, deep confusion about God. We got to get better at explaining who God is. Second issue I run into all the time, deep confusion about the Bible. About the Bible. Oh, what's the Bible? It's pre-scientific nonsense. What's the Bible? A bunch of Bronze Age myths. What's the Bible? A lot of silly ancient fairy tales. You ever see Bill Maher, the comedian who's got the, what's his show? Now, my mother thinks I'm overexposed. I think he's the most overexposed guy in America. What's his show called? Real Time, which I do watch when it comes on the cable because, boy, there's nobody better at misunderstanding everything about religion. Honest to God. I mean, he's clever and smart, but no one misunderstands religion more than Bill Maher. And he's constantly saying this about the Bible. and usually dragging some poor person on who's a fundamentalist, basically, and can't defend the Catholic view of the Bible. Okay. Here's the first thing to say about this. The question of literalism, right? Take the Bible literally. Well, here's the right question to ask in response. Do you take the library literally? See, because the Bible is not a book. It is in one sense. I mean, there's a coherency to it, and that's another lecture. But the Bible is not a book. It's a library, right? It's a collection of books. That's why the word Biblia, that's the plural. It means the books. Our word Bible comes from the books. It's a library, a variety of texts written by a wide range of authors to a widely diverse set of audiences with very different purposes and using very different genre. Think for a second, is there, you know, more or less straightforward history in the Bible? Yeah, sure. Look at 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, the book, the 1 and 2 Chronicles. There are, and parts of the book of Exodus, etc., are more straightforward history. But is there poetry in the Bible? Well, of course, read the Psalms, you know. Is there saga in the Bible? Yeah, I would say there's the beginning of the book of Genesis, parts of Exodus, etc., many others. Are there letters in the Bible? Yeah, letters of Paul. Is there apocalypse in the Bible? Yeah, the book of Revelation, the book of Daniel. Apocalypse has its own purpose and form and literary style. There's a whole range of different genres, different books in this great library that we call Biblia, the books, the Bible. And so the question that's appropriate is, do you take the Bible literally? Do you take the library literally? Well, it depends what section you're in, right? I mean, if you wander into your library and you're in the history section and you're reading Winston Churchill's History of World War II, well, yeah, that's meant to be taken as a more or less straightforward account. Or you run into a journalistic section, sure. Let's say you wander into the poetry section of the library. You wander into the literature section. You pick up Moby Dick. Well, that's a real historical account of what really happened. Well, there are elements of history in it, sure. But it's a novel, it's not history. You pick up T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland. Oh, that's a literal, come on, it's a poem. What you have to do, of course, is put on different glasses all the time, different interpretive lenses, right, when you approach these texts. And so the first response is, don't turn the books, the Biblia, the Bible, into one book, read with one clunky set of lenses. Vatican II was very strong on this, that we be sensitive to genre, right? The different types of writing going on in the Bible. Here's a great line, goes back to the ancient church, Vatican II repeated it. Is the Bible the word of God? Yeah, it's the word of God. But then, comma, in the words of men. And that solves a lot of problems. The Bible's the word of God. It's inspired by God. Inspirare, breath, right? Breathing. What breathes through it is the divine truth. But it's in the words of men, of human beings. And therefore conditioned by culture, language, history, and all sorts of ways. Notice too, please, the point I made in the beginning, the non-competitive God. I mean, why didn't God just dictate the Bible? Like the way a Muslim would see the Quran, is simply dictated by God. Well, no, God delights in cooperating with people like us, cooperating with the great authors of the scripture, using their minds, their skill, and their culturally conditioned perspective to express his word, the word of God, but in the words of men. Here's one thing I found in responding to this stuff. What people love to do, of course, on the internet is they'll take some passage from the Bible and say, but the Bible says this, right? One line or one phrase or a verse. Can I suggest to you, everybody, never take that seriously. That is never a good way to read the Bible. How come? Because the Bible has to be read in its totality. And what we look for are not individual isolated passages. We look for the great patterns and trajectories within the books through which the wisdom of God is breathing. Through all of the inspired books, looking at patterns and trajectories, then we come to know what the Bible truly teaches. And can I suggest that too is a very important interpretive phrase. It's not so much what's in the Bible. There's a lot of stuff in the Bible. But what does the Bible teach? It's a difference there. You know, for example, if you look at the beginning of Genesis, you take it perfectly literally, there's light before there's the sun, right? God says, let there be light on day one. It's only day four that the sun comes around. So that's in the Bible, but I suggest to you, it's not what the Bible's teaching. The Bible doesn't really care about astronomy at that point. Look for patterns and trajectories within the collection of books through which the wisdom of God is breathing. That's a better way to approach it. Now, believe me, I've done this on the internet when people make the objection about the Bible, and I'll try to respond with some of these clarifications. What do I hear invariably in response? You're just cherry picking, right? You're just picking the little elements out of the Bible that you like, and you're forgetting about all the other ones. No. What I'm doing is trying to read the Bible, the books, responsibly within an interpretive tradition. Now, let me clarify what I mean here. Suppose you've got a kid who's bright, let's say 13 or 14 years old, the good reader, love to read novels and poetry. Would you just say, here's Hamlet? Knock yourself out, you know? Here's Hamlet, just read it, and I trust you'll be able to figure out pretty much on your own. Well, of course not. I mean, first of all, he wouldn't get a lot of the words themselves would go over his head. But then, a fortiori, the thematics of Hamlet, what Hamlet means in the richest sense, the humanism of Hamlet, the theology implicit in Hamlet, Hamlet and it's the view of human nature and the soul. And of course he wouldn't get that. You wouldn't just hand him the book and say, read. What would you say? Start working with a good commentary that reflects a long interpretive tradition around Hamlet. And then as you get older, read ever more sophisticated interpretations of Hamlet. Maybe go watch several versions of Hamlet. And then with the group, discuss what it means. What's my point? I hope I'm not belaboring it. But you don't just say, pick up Hamlet on your own and read it. In the same way, we Catholics don't think it's wise just to pick up the books of the Bible, the Biblia, and just read it. You'll do fine. No, no, no. We think it should be read within this great, complex, ancient interpretive tradition that we call the Church. Augustine read the Bible and talked about it. Origen read the Bible and shared his reflections. Jerome read the Bible with tremendous perception. Anselm read the Bible. Thomas Aquinas wrote extraordinary Bible commentaries. John Henry Newman wrote these densely textured, beautifully crafted sermons. G.K. Chesterton read the Bible. John Paul II read the Bible and shared. Why wouldn't we read all these people that interpret the patterns and trajectories of the Bible to us? See, what I do when I get the cherry-picking charge is I'll make it a counter-argument in favor of the Catholic approach to the Bible. It's within this great interpretive tradition that we know how to read this variegated and very complex book. Read the Bible inside the Church and you'll get it. You know, an image here, by the way, is St. Thomas and the wounds of Christ. When was Thomas confused about the resurrected Jesus? Precisely when he wasn't in the Church. See, I'm driving it. He wasn't there the first time Jesus came. And they reported it to him, and using his own mind, his own ruminations, he said, oh, I don't believe it. But then when he returned to the upper room with the others, now he sees. See, now he gets it. Now he believes. So the Bible has to be read within the Church. Okay, so God, people are confused about God. People are confused about the Bible. The Bible becomes a scandal to them. Thirdly, and here we come to the advertised topic, There is deep confusion out there in internet land, trust me, about the relation between religion and science. Again, the Bronze Age mythology comes in here, right? Why should we believe pre-scientific musings? Why would we take any of that seriously from the ancient world? These people didn't even know what a virus was. They didn't know about atoms and cells and molecules. Why would we take this literature seriously? The problem here is what we call scientism. Scientism. Let me just say right off the bat, the Catholic Church reverences the sciences. Let there be no ambiguity about that. The Catholic Church reverences the sciences. The Catholic Church, really, of all the great Christian dispensations, is the one that has most consistently reverenced the use of reason. In our contemporary setting, it's not so much philosophy, but it's science that's seen as the bearer of reason. Well, the Catholic Church, I'll say it again, reverences reason, and it reverences the sciences. But what doesn't it like? It doesn't like scientism. Now, what do I mean by that? What I mean is the reduction of all forms of knowing to the scientific mode of knowing. Does that make sense? It's an epistemological observation. How do we know? How do we know things? There's only one way. That's the scientific way. Now, that's scientism. What's the scientific way of knowing? Well, you observe. You form a hypothesis to explain what you've seen. You test the hypothesis with experimentation. And then you go back and test it again to verify it. And then you make a judgment. That's the best hypothesis, right? The scientific method, developed in the late 16th, early 17th century, applied now with massive success all over the place. Think of the rise of the sciences since the early or the late 16th century. Think of how they've come to dominate our consciousness appropriately, legitimately. Think, moreover, of the technology attendant upon the success of the sciences. I mean, it's all around us, the electrical lights, this microphone, which is now working a little bit better, huh? Would anybody in this room want to go back to a pre-scientific age? You know, by the way, the other night up in Santa Barbara, I was giving a talk on ecumenism and the Pope's recent letter and so on. And I threw away that line. I said, does anyone here want to go back to a pre-scientific age? And there was a guy in the room who said, I would. I said, oh, come on, you would not. So my point is, sciences are great. Science is great, the church reverences it. However, not all forms of knowing are reducible to the scientific form of knowing. For example, read Homer, read Aeschylus, read Plato, Aristotle, or Cicero, read Thomas Aquinas, read Augustine, read Dante the poet. Would you ever be tempted to say these people know nothing of any importance? These people have nothing important to communicate to us. See, they've come to know very profound truths that cannot be known using the scientific method. Truths about the mind, truths about love, truths about human identity, truths about love and relationship, truths about the beautiful, the true, and the good. See, there are so many other ways of knowing the world that aren't reducible to the scientific method. A great danger we face today is the attenuation of all those other forms of knowing because of the dominance of the scientific form. Here's another problem, by the way, a serious one for those in the grip of scientism. Scientism is, in fact, self-refuting. How come? Well, the principle, the only legitimate knowledge is knowledge derivable from the scientific method. Well, where did you observe that? Where did you experiment to discover that truth? When did you form a hypothesis and then test it through experimentation? See, it's self-refuting. That very idea was not derived from the scientific method. Rather, it was derived from a kind of philosophical intuition. So if you can use philosophy, why can't I? If your knowledge is not reducible to science, why should mine? See, in some ways, the victim of scientism has backed himself into a corner. You know, something else, I'd say practically every day I would see on the internet forums. Who's the patron saint of scientism in the minds of many? Galileo, right? Galileo, this early scientist who was making all these wonderful discoveries, observing, experimenting, opposed by the wicked, obscurantist, backward-looking Catholic Church that stopped him, censored him, silenced him, and eventually imprisoned him. Can I suggest to you, that myth is like a myth of origins for modern scientism. And that's why it has to be brought out again and again. You know what I'm saying? It's like that has to be told over and over again in almost a liturgical way. Now, here's my point. I'm not proud of the Galileo part of our history. It was a bad moment, no question about it. But first observation, there are a lot of complexities in the Galileo situation. It's not as black and white as people propose. And that's another lecture for another night, to talk about just Galileo. But let me take a step even beyond it. To claim that Galileo, which is one paragraph in one chapter of a very long book, to claim that that one paragraph is paradigmatic, that is deeply, profoundly misleading. In fact, who were some of Galileo's earliest confreres? Jesuit priests, who were doing a lot of the observation, experimenting with telescopes as he was, very interested in planetary movement, et cetera, advocating the Copernican view of the universe. Some of the earliest people to do all of that were Jesuit priests. Moreover, almost every major founder of the scientific method was a devoutly believing religious person. I'm talking about Descartes. I'm talking about Newton. I'm talking about Tycho Brahe. I'm talking about Copernicus himself. And mind you, Galileo himself, despite his struggles with the church, was himself a devoutly believing person. The founders of the sciences did not see a terrible warfare between science and religion, but saw them both as modes of knowing, one with its distinctive method, but the other with its own distinctive method. And now let me take a further step. I know the mythology says that the sciences emerged only out of a long twilight struggle against religion. Right? Only after a long battle against backward-looking obscurantist Catholicism did the sciences emerge. Everybody, that is so much nonsense. Go on my YouTube page. I did a video years ago about this. And all I did in the video, was mention the religious figures, so monks or priests and so on, who were themselves scientists. And this video went on for quite a long time, simply listing these religious figures who were also scientists. But now push it another step. I subscribe to the view that religion was not the implacable enemy of science, but in fact, religion, Christianity in particular, was the condition for the possibility of the emergence of the sciences. See, ask yourself the question, why did the modern sciences, as we know them, the physical sciences, emerge where and when they did? They didn't emerge in China, for example, or in Asia. They did not emerge in the Middle East. They did not emerge in Africa. How come they emerged where and when they did? I think quite persuasive is the argument that they did so because they emerged out of a Christian thought world, a Christian intellectual milieu. Now, what do I mean? What are two conditions for the possibility of the modern physical sciences? I'd say, first of all, the conviction that the world is not God. Now, that might sound trivial, but think of how many cultures and civilizations have divinized the world. these forms of pantheism or nature mysticism. If the world is God, if nature is divinized, what don't you do? Well, you don't experiment on it. You worship it. You honor it. I'm not necessarily bad-mouthing it. There's great truth in that. But what's not going to happen is the emergence of the sciences. Because you won't cut up and dissect and experiment upon something that you're worshiping as divine, right? All the way from ancient animism to Star Wars, you know, may the force be with you. What's the force, as Joseph Campbell, who inspired Star Wars, said, it's the zoom of energy that runs through all things, the sacred force that runs through the universe. Well, if that's your view, you're not going to experiment on the world. You're going to worship it. What's the second condition? The assumption and intuition that the world in its entirety is intelligible. Now again, that sounds like a commonplace, but think about it. To get a science off the ground, what do you have to assume? You have to assume, whether you're a chemist, a physicist, a biologist, a psychologist, whatever you are, you have to assume that the world you're going out to meet is intelligible, it's understandable. It's got a form, a pattern, and a meaning. Right? Otherwise, why bother? If the world's just chaotic, without structure or form, you won't go out to meet it with your inquiring mind. Right? Thomas Aquinas sums up this tradition by saying, ens est scibile. It just means being is knowable. Now, it sounds like, well, this is a commonplace, but it's not a commonplace. Why do we just naturally assume the world has a pattern, form, meaning? Intelligibility. I'll tell you why. Because we came out of a Christian thought world which taught the doctrine of creation. Now look at my two assumptions. That the world is not God, but yet the world is totally intelligible. Where does that come from? The view that God made the world in its entirety. If he made it, it's not him. Right? If he made it, it's different than he. It's not divine. And if he made it in its entirety, it is in its entirety marked by intelligibility. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And through that Word, everything came to be that was made. Can I suggest to you, it's people that learned that doctrine and believed it that were able to launch the modern physical sciences. The world isn't God, but yet it's touched by a divine intelligibility. That's how Descartes got off the ground. That's how Newton got off the ground. Because they came up out of this loamy and rich theological tradition. That's why it always bugs me when, according to the modern myth, religion and science are presented as implacable enemies. I would see them, in fact, as father to son, mother to daughter relationship. It's a Christian thought world that gave rise to the sciences. Just a last observation, because I love telling the story because most Catholics don't know it. You know the Big Bang theory of cosmic origins that almost everybody subscribes to now, right? That there was this singularity where all of, you know, what became time and matter, energy, was all concentrated in one great point, which then explodes and then keeps expanding, and that's the universe that we're studying even to this day, the Big Bang theory. You know who formulated that? A fellow named Georges Lemaître. Georges Lemaître was Father Georges Lemaître. He was a Catholic priest. And there's wonderful photos. Go on my website and you'll see we did a video on this. Lemaître had to convince Einstein, because Einstein didn't believe this theory. And Lemaître eventually convinced Einstein. So we found these wonderful photos of Georges Lemaître with a big Roman collar about 8 inches tall, you know, at a blackboard, and Einstein is standing here, and he's like, that's interesting. But see, who would have, how many people today, even Catholics, know that one of our priests, a Catholic priest, formulated the Big Bang theory of cosmic origins? Religion and science are not implacable enemies. So when you hear that, I hear it every day, because people believe the modern mythology. Battle it. In fact, they're mutually implicative.
Okay, one more. I'm going on a little bit long here. One more, and maybe the most important in terms of blocking people, religion in relation to violence. There's an old argument. Goes back to the Enlightenment, goes back to the 17th century. And it runs like this. Religion's irrational. Therefore, the only way religious people can adjudicate their disputes is through violence. Because they can't really argue, it's irrational. So the only recourse they have is to violence. Now, to be fair to that argument, there's a lot of evidence that would support it, namely the violence of religious people. For the early modern thinkers, these Enlightenment figures, it was the wars of religion in the 17th century. You know, remember that period after the Reformation when Protestants and Catholics were battling all over Europe, culminating in the 30 Years' War from 1618 to 1648? That's a huge influence in our intellectual lives, because a lot of the brightest minds of Europe said, this is stupid. This can't last. We can't have religious people who are debating about the Pope's authority and transubstantiation and all that. We can't have them ravaging the whole continent, see? Religion is irrational, therefore violent. So, what did a lot of the moderns try to find? They tried to find a rational and nonviolent form of religion. Now read Kant, Hegel, Spinoza, Leibniz, Jefferson. A whole slew of modern thinkers tried to find a rational, reasonable form of religion. So John Locke, very influential on our founding fathers, writes a book called The Reasonableness of Christianity. Kant writes a book called Religion Within the Limits of Reason Alone. What did Thomas Jefferson do? Remember Jefferson's Bible? Where he literally took a razor and cut out supernatural elements in the New Testament and presented Jesus as a reasonable moral teacher, right? But all the miracles and demons and all this kind of wild stuff, he cut that out. And you can find it. Go to the bookstore. Find Jefferson's Bible. All the great moderns were trying to deal with the problem of violence. When was all this revived? I'll tell you exactly when it was. September 11th, 2001. When those planes flew into the buildings, people, you know, in the name of the God of Abraham, it stirred up the old Enlightenment argument. Look, there it is again, religion, it's irrational, and therefore it's violent. It's no accident whatsoever that Hitchens and Dawkins and Sam Harris and Dennett and all the new atheists emerged right after September 11th. Okay. What's Hitchens' book subtitled? How Religion Poisons Everything. And there it is. There's the evidence. Look at what happens with religion. Okay. Trust me, the disciples of the new atheists are everywhere in internet land. And boy, do they know the texts in the Bible that bug them. Because, you know, to be fair, there are a lot of violent texts in the Bible where God seems to be giving commands to do terrible things. The one they focus on, and they know chapter and verse, by the way, when it comes to violence. They can tell you exactly where this is in the Bible. Do you remember in the first book of Samuel, the story of Saul putting the ban on the Amalekites? Remember that? The ban, as you know, meant kill every man, woman, child, and animal of the conquered city. So Saul has conquered the Amalekites, and Samuel, the prophet, conveys God's desire that you put the ban on these people. Kill every man, woman, child, and animal. And so Saul wins the battle, kills almost everybody, but he leaves a few for his own purposes, a few animals and a few of the people, including the king of the Amalekites, whose name is Agag. Not the best name in the history of names. Anyway, who shows up? Well, the prophet Samuel. And Saul goes, hey, look, I won the battle. Samuel says, I heard the bleating of sheep, and I heard the cry of these cattle, and I see you've got King Agag over there with some of his officials. Why didn't you put the ban on these people? And Saul goes, oh, well, you know, I did pretty well. I killed almost everybody, but I did keep a few. It says, Samuel then stirred with rage, killed the animals, killed the courtiers of Agag, had the king dragged over, and then it says, with his sword, he hacked Agag to pieces. And then you say, the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Okay. Okay, that's That's in the Bible. But remember my distinction from a while ago? What's in the Bible ain't necessarily what's being taught. Okay. And there are passages like that one. It's not isolated. There are others like it. So what do we do with this? Because people say, look, there's the problem. Your own God is bloodthirsty. And that's why September 11th and the wars of religion, they're bound to happen with this crazy, irrational God you have. Well, is this a problem that we discovered or that the Enlightenment discovered? This goes right back to the beginning of Christianity. From the earliest centuries, our thinkers and theologians wrestle with this problem. And here's one of the very best, I think, still illuminating today. The great theologian Origen, who wrote in the second and early third centuries, a long time ago, close to apostolic times, he saw this problem. I mean, how do you defend this God, especially in light of this fellow up here, right? How do you reconcile these things? Well, here's Origen's approach. I think it's really enlightening. He said, Christians read the whole Bible from the standpoint of the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation. Now, what did he mean? Well, remember there's a scene in the book of Revelation when the seer, so John, you know, the author of the book, has been taken up into heaven. And he's there in the very sort of, you know, a court of God. And he sees elders and there's incense and there are trumpets and a kind of liturgy going on. And then a scroll comes out, a scroll with seven seals. Who will open the scroll is the question that someone asks. Who will open the scroll? Well, what is that scroll? Think of it as the entire Bible. It's the whole Bible sealed with the seven seals. But who will open its meaning to us? That's the question. See, who will interpret this for us? And it's the seer, in fact, weeps because no one will come out to open it. Then we hear, the Lion of Judah will come, the Lion will open the scroll. But instead of a lion, out comes a little lamb. And then it says the lamb is standing as though slain. It's peculiar, the Greek there is very peculiar. So a lamb? I'm waiting for a lion, a lamb comes out? And then a lamb who's wounded, it's like the weakest possible figure, right? Now, we know who that is. It's the Lord Jesus. Is the Lamb of God standing as though slain? Now, here's Origen's point. Now, this is very important. It is only from the standpoint of the crucified Jesus that we properly understand the whole of the Bible. If our interpretation of any part of the Bible is at variance with that figure, we are misinterpreting it. That's the point. Okay, I'm with you so far, but what do we do then with Agag and hacking him to pieces? So here's Origen's reading. Origen says, we cannot read those as literal, straightforward prescriptions, but we must read those passages as a series of spiritual symbols. Now, it opens up. The Amalekites, the Egyptians, the Philistines, the Assyrians, the Greeks, the Romans, throughout the Bible, stand for all those things in the world that are opposed to God. Just as the Israelites stand for God's purposes in the world. But we know that. God's purpose in the world is always opposed by dark forces. So how do you deal with these dark forces? Most of us, Origen said this, most of us pussyfoot around with them. You know what I'm saying? Oh, we'll battle evil to some degree, but we'll leave a little bit too for ourselves. Yeah, we'll fight it. Oh, yeah, but we'll keep a little bit on the side for ourselves. We play around with the forces of evil. What is God telling us? To put the ban on it. You see, I'm driving it now. To put the ban on evil in the world. Here now, think. Injustice and hatred and racism and violence. The idea is we need, as a Christian church, to put the ban on these things, to battle them all the way down. Yes, to hack them to pieces. Now you see, when you spiritualize the text, it opens up and you say, that's what we should be doing and we often don't do. Let me just give you a couple examples. Suppose a husband says to his wife, you know, honey, I love you with all my heart, and our marriage means the world to me, and that's why I am faithful to you 90% of the time. Right? Or if I went to Archbishop Gomez and said, oh, Archbishop, I love being a bishop. I thank you for this privilege, and what a joy. I've been a priest for 30 years. I love the priesthood. And that's why I'm celibate, except when I'm on vacation. You know what I mean? Otherwise. Now, you can see what they would say. Or like, you know, your doctor says to you, oh, no, you're doing great. We got 80% of that cancer. You know, the problem is we don't hack evil to pieces. We play around with it with halfway measures. Now look back at the Lamb standing as though slain. What did he do on that cross? But he went all the way down, like Frodo into Mordor, who's a great Christ figure. You have to go all the way in. You can't play around. You gotta go all the way into Mount Doom and throw that ring in. He's gotta go all the way down to our dysfunction at every level. Yes, accepting, as Paul said, even death, death on a cross. What did Jesus do with sin and death? He hacked them to pieces. He didn't play around with them. He fought them all the way down. See, and now we see what the Bible is all about. Whether Israel's fighting Amalek or Egypt or the Philistines or the Greeks or the Romans, it's the great drama of our struggle with evil. God wants us to do it all the way. But we tend to do it by halfway measures. Can I suggest that's a good way to read the violent passages in the Bible? And that's from a third century spiritual master. That's no new theory. That's a very old theory. Okay, let me end with this. Something I feel passionately about, maybe you've sensed from the talk, I hope, is we need a new apologetics. There are a lot of people in the culture who just hate religion, especially Catholic religion, by the way. Talk for another night. But they hate religion. And they're coming at us. They're coming at us. My generation was taught not to do apologetics because it was defensive and it was non-ecumenical and it looked, you know. I think we need a new apologetics. These are the big four, in my judgment, based on not just theorizing but a lot of practical experience. These are the big four. Are we properly armed? Are the kids, our kids, properly ready to defend the faith? My generation got a dumbed-down Catholicism, I think, which has been a pastoral disaster. If some were there, 2 years ago I gave the big talk at the Congress. In my wildest dreams, I never thought I'd be back as a bishop of Los Angeles, but I gave a talk and I talked about how we've done this to ourselves. No one came in and compelled us to dumb down our faith. We did it to ourselves. Our high school kids, you know this, are reading Shakespeare. They're reading Virgil's Aeneid. They're reading Einstein in science. And we're giving them comic books for religion. Why aren't we reading with our kids religion at the highest level? I think we need to be steeled for this work of spreading and defending our faith. We know what the problems are, but are we equipped as a church to address them? And that's something I'll close with this. When Dave introduced me to the university series, and he said one thing he wanted to do was to make it harder. We should really dumb down the thing so more people will come. That's a bad formula, and he saw that correctly, I think, is to make it more challenging, more difficult, so that we can rise proudly to the challenge. And so I'm very proud to be a speaker in this series, be one voice among many, but as part of this resolution, that we'll be strong in our faith and strong in the knowledge of our faith. That's the kind of new apologetics we need today. God bless you all. Thanks for listening tonight. very nice. Thank you.
Do we have any questions? Yes.
Why did it take so long for Galileo to be reunited with the church?
Yeah, and you're right in suggesting it took too long. And it was John Paul II, who felt very strongly about this issue, who pushed that through. I would say a couple things. One is with the rise of the Enlightenment, and then with the Reformation, the church moved into a very defensive posture vis-a-vis both. And it saw itself as kind of defending itself against the Protestants and against the rationalism of the Enlightenment. And I think that was exaggerated. And the Galileo thing was part of that discussion. And it did not serve us well at all. See, I did my doctoral work on Aquinas and Paul Tillich, the German Protestant theologian. And Tillich had this great line. He said, the church, meaning the church broadly, should meet the culture mit klingendem Spiel, which is German roughly for with fife and drum. You know what I'm saying? That we should not retreat behind walls in a defensive posture, but we should go out mit klingendem Spiel with enthusiasm and with energy, confidence. And I think that's what John Paul was calling us to after Vatican II, but we fell into a very defensive stance for too long.
Bishop, could you explain, please, your view of hell?
Of what?
Hell.
Oh, of hell. Well, hell is the rejection of God. I mean, our whole purpose is to fall in love with God, to surrender to God. Hell is, Augustine had a great image. He said, hell is being incurvatus in se. That means turned in on oneself. So I would envision hell as like this great party's going on, but you won't get involved. I don't want to get involved. I'd rather turn in on myself. Or think of, you know, if you're in a bad mood, who's the most obnoxious person around? Someone in a good mood, right? If you're locked in, so imagine you're with people who have surrendered to God and found deep joy. Hell is refusing to join that party and finding them infinitely annoying. Here's Origen, by the way. Origen said, it's the love of God that lights up the fires of hell. Now, what did he mean by that? The same idea is if you're resisting God's love, it's that love that is like rubbing against you and creating the friction that lights up the fires. It's not that God is sending people to hell, but we send ourselves to hell if anyone is there. Church has never determined that anyone is, for sure. But if there are, they've turned so against the divine love that it lights up the fires of suffering. That's why hell begins here. We all know what hell is. We've all been there, right? When you're refusing the divine love, it's lighting up fires of suffering in you. That's what it would be.
Yes, sir.
Please. Yeah. Monk, yeah.
So if it wasn't for him inventing science and genetics, we wouldn't have had all these vaccines.
Yeah.
Medications.
Yeah, it's a very good observation about Gregor Mendel, of course, who's the founder of genetics in the modern sense, is a Augustinian friar. And so, yeah, it's still another example of the coming together.
Right. The question was, what about the comment was, Mendel,
the father of genetics, and what was his role
in Catholicism and the church? And that's what Bishop explained.
Yeah.
Some
more over here.
What are the next steps for this new apologetics? How do we get there?
Yeah, thank you for that. The first one, I think, is we got to teach our kids to read the great tradition and not serve them pablum, but serve them the great works of our tradition. So we need to educate ourselves. We got to learn to use the new media, I think is key. We have to be out there where people are. We can't expect them to come to our institutions to be evangelized or to hear apologetics. We have to move into their space. And so get, especially young people who know that stuff in their bones and their fingers, get them involved. But I think read the great tradition, get informed, come to series like this. Go out mit klingendem Spiel, go out with energy, confidence. Go on, the Mormon website. No one's doing web stuff better than the Mormons right now. They're way ahead of us. Look at the Mormon website compared to the Vatican website. Vatican website is like pages and pages of text and little print and stuff. I mean, no one's going to read that. There are much better ways to engage younger people through the new media. So I'd say those are a couple things. But I always tell my students at Mundelein when I was rector there, I want to get involved in the web. I want to do, you know, what you're doing. And I'll say, stay with the old medium of books first. Read, 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 read. And then you have something to say when you use the new media.
So this long question really comes down to your first point about understanding God.
Yeah.
That God is love, and we don't understand love. How do we understand love in relationship with God and in relationship with the church?
Well, we do understand something of God. So when I say God is not the end summum, and I make a distinction, he's ipsum esse, that's knowing something about God. And we can know certain truths, even though they're all inadequate. To love is to will the good of the other. And see, God, that's all God can do vis-a-vis the world, because God is God. He has no needs. Irenaeus said that in the 3rd century. God needs nothing. Therefore what? When he wills vis-a-vis the world, how does he will? Only externally, only for our good. He has no self-interest. Thank God. God doesn't need us, therefore he can love us. He wills the good of the other. That's the bracing definition Thomas Aquinas gives of love. It's not a feeling or a sentiment. It's an act of the will. When I say, I want your good, not my good through you. That's the usual trick that we sinners pull. You know, well, I'll be nice to you so that you may be nice to me, right? I'll be just to you that you might be just to me. But that isn't love. That's why greater love hath no man than to what? To lay down his life, because that means it's not self-interest. How could it be? So that's what God is through and through. When God seizes us through grace, we can become conformed to that life. And now look at the saints. That's who the saints are. They love with the very love of God. So it's a hugely important theme, love, you know. Yeah, I taught a course years ago in Teilhard de Chardin. I mean, what could you say? He's a very important thinker, very influential on Vatican II. Much of Gaudium et Spes is marked by Teilhard. I wouldn't be completely sympathetic to him, but I think there are a lot of important themes. I love his book, The Divine Milieu. I think is a great book of spirituality. I'm a little less convinced of some of the ways he tries to adapt evolution theory to theology, but it's a big question. I think there's a lot of good, and there are some things I balk at in Teilhard. He's faded from the scene, too. I mean, almost no one reads him in theology now. He was very much in vogue in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And now I hardly ever read anything about him in theology.
A question for you here, Bishop. How does one defend against Stephen Hawking, who says the universe doesn't need a creator?
Yeah. No, I'm glad to hear that question. Read Robert Spitzer, who's out here now. Do you know Father Robert Spitzer? I think his books are wonderful. He was actually on Larry King with Stephen Hawking, and it was a bad show. They never gave Spitzer a chance to talk. It is so much nonsense to say the universe comes from nothing. When they say nothing, they're using it in a very ambiguous way. When philosophers say nothing, they mean nothing, like non-being. Being does not come from non-being. When they say nothing, they mean this kind of elemental quantum soup, which is deeply potential, full of all sorts of energies, and that things pop out of this kind of quantum soup, sure, but that's not nothing. It's deeply misleading when they use that language. I find it amusing, frankly, when I'm supposed to be the representative of the irrational, superstitious religion, and we're the defenders now of a coherent view that contingent being has to come from some finally non-contingent source. And the answer to that is, oh no, things pop out of being from nothing. That's the rational position? So I think that's so much nonsense, and it's very misleading. Read to William Lane Craig. Do you know that name? He's one of the finest apologists today, and he knows the scientific stuff, as Spitzer does. And they're very good at debunking the Stephen Hawking thing. He's a great scientist. He's a lousy philosopher, in my judgment.
Can you give us a list of books, authors that we can study so we can begin learning apologetics ourselves and pass on to our kids?
Yeah, good. Peter Kraft, Robert Spitzer, I think is very good. Read C.S. Lewis. I think Mere Christianity is still a great place to start for people. Read G.K. Chesterton's Orthodoxy. And then the classics, you know, go back to Origen, Augustine, Thomas Aquinas, John Henry Newman. There's a rebirth of apologetics going on right now. Read Brant Petrie. Do you know that name? Great biblical scholar. Just wrote a book. I was privileged to write the preface to it. And it's called The Case for Jesus. And he's making the argument on deeply biblical grounds that Jesus claimed to be God, that Jesus is divine, that the resurrection happened. And he's taking on all the debunkers. So those are a few. I mean, Peter Kraft, C.S. Lewis, Robert Spitzer, Brant Petrie, and then the great classics, you know.
And wouldn't we find this on your Word on Fire website, perchance?
Yeah, but also go on, my friend Brandon Vogt, V-O-G-T, has a site called Strange Notions, and it's a Christian outreach to atheists and agnostics. His front page of his website has 20 arguments for God's existence and references to them, and takes on all of the debunking people. Brandon Vogt, V-O-G-T.
Are you in a position to influence Catholic education in our schools to introduce apologetics there?
Well, I don't know is my honest answer, because auxiliary bishops don't have a lot of authority. I can certainly press it. I did in Chicago as much as I could. My work in general has been an attempt to influence the way we train our young people. So I'd like to, if I can, but that's up to Jose Gomez. I don't know if I have the authority to really press on it here. Pardon me?
Bring it up to us.
Yeah, I have. Please.
Who killed more people, Lucifer or God? Given all this violence we read in the Bible.
Yeah, well, again, keep Origen in mind, though. It's a misleadingly phrased question, because God doesn't kill anyone in the Bible. We have to read the Bible in light of the Lamb standing as though slain and attendant to the, you know, cultural conditions of the time. I would say God kills no one in the Bible. If God killed someone, God would be a sinner and the whole moral enterprise would come undone. So I think phrasing it that way is misleading. Yeah.
So how right. Do we explain to atheists suffering of children, things that our God would not allow to happen?
Yeah, and it's, you know, it's the question in many ways. Some people argue that all of theology is essentially theodicy, which is your question. How do you justify God in the face of suffering? It's the most emotionally powerful argument, because we all feel it. I mean, anyone that's suffered the loss of a loved one, we all felt it. Practically every day when I was doing parish work, you feel it because you're dealing with people who are facing it. I faced it when my dad died. I mean, so from an emotional, personal standpoint, very, very quick answer. From an intellectual standpoint, it's not a powerful argument. Why? Because how can we possibly assume that a finite mind could grasp the workings of an infinite mind? Now, there's the point of the book of Job, right? Is when Job brings up to God this, you know, his horrific suffering, and God's great speech, the longest speech by God anywhere in the Bible, is taking Job on a tour of the cosmos. Where were you when I did this? Where were you when I did, you know? And the point is, it's a very simple point, but telling, how could a finite mind ever understand the workings of an infinite mind? Just like a little kid, you know, something happens, or you do something, you punish, and the kid is just dumb suffering. And somehow you're involved in it? My own mother is involved in this? And you couldn't even in principle explain. Because the difference in your minds will now raise that to the infinite degree. Which is why we usually suggest that's the answer to Job. Right? The answer to Job is God joining us in our suffering. He can't explain it. Finite minds can't take in the workings of an infinite mind. But God shows solidarity with us in our suffering. So when you bring those two features together, you get a, you know, answer, kind of as best we can. But it's the question in many ways.
Back to our understanding of God for a moment. Is God the process of being?
Is he what now?
The process of being.
No, he's the act of to be. See, I don't subscribe to process theology. It sounded like process theology, as though God is becoming the same way that the world becomes. God is actus purus, pure act, pure actuality, which means the full perfection of being. If God were in process, then God would be moving towards some fulfillment he doesn't have, which would make him a big creature, not God. Rather, I would say God is the sheer energy of to be itself, utterly realized, utterly fulfilled, which then, Lonergan's language, fulfills the conditions of all contingent things. I'm just a little too philosophical. But no, I would not say he's the process of being. I'd say he's the act of to be. I'm sure that clears it all up.
In the new apologetics, how do we deal with the relativism?
Yeah, good. You know, I was just talking to someone about this who said that's his first move, is to try to combat relativism. Because if you're a relativist, then we can't get any traction. It's your truth and my truth, but there's no truth. There's what's good for you, but it's not good for me. There's no goodness itself. And so you're right. If we're stuck in what Pope Benedict called the dictatorship of relativism, we can't get any traction. Lots of times people on my YouTube forum will say something like, you know, there's no truth, it's just my truth and your truth, all truth is relative. Then my answer is, well, then why should I listen to you? You know what I'm saying? If all truth is relative, aren't you making a truth claim? And so the best way around relativism in the exaggerated way is Augustine's way, long time ago, which is just that, is that the relativist himself is making an absolute truth claim. And if you say, oh no, I'm just making a relative truth claim, well, isn't that an absolute truth claim? See, you can't get around it, that all of us willy-nilly are making truth claims. And therefore, I can't live in a completely relativistic world. And once you get that little traction, you know, you get a little foothold, then you can show a lot of things. I remember debating someone about intrinsic moral evil. You know, I was arguing there are things that are intrinsically morally evil. Oh, no, they're not. It's all culturally conditioned. It's all up to the individual. It's all blah, blah, blah. And I said, how about the sexual abuse of children? That's cultural condition. And if I feel like it, I can do it. Or another culture says, no, oh, that's fine. How about slavery? Right? I mean, once you think a little bit, there's all kinds of moral absolutes that we never want to say that's just a matter of relativism. So I think once you sort of tease people a bit, you can get them out of a relativistic framework. But you're right, that can be a major block.
You mentioned Bill Maher. Would you ever consider going on his show?
Yeah, he's never, I'd go on if he asked. He's never asked. He's had Ross Douthat on. You know Ross Douthat, a columnist for the New York Times? Very bright guy. And he's been on with Bill Maher, and I think he makes Bill Maher look ridiculous, because what Bill usually does is bring on people that can't really defend the faith at all. But I'd go on if he asked, but he hasn't asked me yet.
If atheism is so great, where in atheism do we find all the works of charity, the works of compassion?
Yeah, and that's a big point of argument. Sometimes atheists will say to me, look, atheists can be, you know, good people. And I don't deny that. I'm sure there are atheists who are very decent people. But I would challenge them, you knock God out of the equation, before you know it, the moral system begins to collapse because there's no absolute criterion. What will happen is you'll quickly devolve into a relativism. Once God's out of the picture, it'll, yeah, that's good for me, but not necessarily for you. So I would challenge people, it's dangerous knocking God out of the moral equation.
As a final question, suppose that we did everything that you outlined. We understand God, we understand the Bible, we understand the role of science and violence. What would our world look like?
Well, I mean, I'm making a more modest claim tonight, which is it would give us much better traction against those who are opposed to the faith. So it would lure people closer to the Catholic faith, I think. I wouldn't want to make a claim beyond that, like it's going to solve the problems of the world. But it might help to solve the problem of blocking people's access to the Catholic faith. So I would hope it would give people a certain toehold. It would just give them a little more confidence to keep walking toward the Catholic faith. But that's the only claim I would make. It's not anything more grandiose than that.
Thank you. I'd like to make one final pitch to the university series. As many of you may know, we incorporated last year as University Series Foundation, Inc., a nonprofit corporation. And of course, we have a board of directors. And the board recently voted unanimously to have Bishop Barron join us.
you.
Bishop Barron, on behalf of this part of your pastoral region, we are delighted that you took the time to come and join us and share so many wonderful insights. We hope you'll come back to this side of the region again to join us.
I'd be happy to.
Let's thank Bishop Barron.
Thank you. God bless you all.